Welcome to the Canine HS Bitesize Canine Anatomy series, and we're going to explore biceps brachii this evening. And I'm so grateful for all the amazing feedback that we've been receiving from this series. And just in case you're new and you've not seen any of the others, you can find them on YouTube on our channel Canine HS, or else you can get them on our website under resources. So really, really excited about this muscle. It was one that Harriet asked to explore and I really wanted to, so it's great to have some feedback. So just to introduce you to this kind of webinar, in case you're new and you haven't been before, if you look along the bottom navigation bar, you can see there's an ask a question. If you've got a question, please put it in there. It's really, really important you don't put it in the chat, because what happens is the chat rolls up as we progress and then we will lose your question, which is really important that you get your questions answered straight away. We've also set up a poll. So if you have a little look along the bottom there, there's a poll. And if you click on the poll, you can vote if you want some more canine muscles, or you want to explore canine joints, or you'd like a mixture. And that's going to give us a really strong guide what you're looking for, because it's really interactive and we want to deliver what you're looking for some really good quality CPD, specifically for canine therapists, whether you're a physiotherapist, hydrotherapist, massage therapist, a bone practitioner, T-touch practitioner. Everybody has functional anatomy at their fingertips, and by reviewing it, we can really explore our treatment choices. So I'm just going to, I don't think there was anything else. Oh, just to mention that the questions are timestamped. So if you see a question that you like, you can vote on it. But when I come to answer the questions, if you could just not vote, because they'll move up and down the screen. Thank you, Sarah. Good to know that the sound and visuals are good. What I see is definitely not what you see. So I'm just going to pull up the slides. Won't be a minute. There we go. Brilliant. And just, there we go. So I think we're set. So sometimes with these live events, people have a team. They have an IT team, someone checking the chat, they have support, and it's just me. And luckily, Sarah's very kindly offered to run the chat, because it's really hard to look at the chat, go through the information, but we've got 20 minutes of really exciting functional canine anatomy about the biceps brachii. So let's begin. So what I want to think about is the approach that you're using, your strategies that you're using for your treatment techniques. And we're very much an assessment-driven therapy, physiotherapy and hydrotherapy. And it's about devising that individual treatment program for the dog based on your assessment findings, and taking in account of the dog's behaviors in your clinical setting as well. And it's going to be whatever age they are, what breed, what problem they've got, it's going to be devising that specific treatment plan for each dog in your care. And what I want to do is just, I say this a lot, and I just want to really emphasize this, is that there's been a little bit of information going out on social media, which I find perplexing. The dog has got four limbs for two reasons: to support the dog up against gravity and to accelerate it forward. And it is designed to go forward in a straight line in the sagittal plane. So let's think what that really means. So the legs are there to support the dog against gravity. So what we're looking for, if you want to improve movement and you want to improve performance or conditioning, we're looking for accessing that support. And to do that, we explore the extensor pattern. So I'm always perplexed when people go on about using a flexor withdrawal or a flexor pattern, because that is what a dog does, a flexor pattern when it's lame. So if you want to improve its loading, improve the function of that limb, you're going to be exploring the extensor pattern, not the flexor pattern. Flexor pattern and protraction is about the dog getting the limb forward, ready for loading. And where the magic really happens is in the retraction phase, when the limb is against the ground. So the power sweep is that part with early stance to mid stance to push off. And that's where we really need to focus and concentrate our treatment techniques, and definitely If you've not looked at the dogs in natural balance motion, take a peek at it. It explores why it's so important to use rhythmical treatment techniques and not use reflexive treatment techniques. So your options and your choices should primarily always be to work with the dog and to optimize that, to optimize the dog's ability to do functional activities and for movement. And you're going to do that through exploring the extensor pattern. And because movement is arranged in patterns, not at a muscle, not at a joint, and definitely not through the reflexes, because reflexes are about protecting the body from harm. We don't want to utilize that unless we really have to. So the dog has four limbs for two reasons: support it against gravity, accelerate it forward in a straight line. The four limbs, the design of the four limbs is specifically for braking and shock absorbing, because they've got this amazing synsarcotic joint between the scapula and the thorax. And the hind limbs, which you can see in the skeleton, they're zigzag. They're great for powering. We know that the dog's engine is in the rear. It pushes forward, and that is a much stronger action than pulling. The dog is not designed to pull itself forward. It's designed to power from the back end. Unless, of course, it's got problems or it's got older and it's losing the back end. So it will adapt. And these secondary patternings are incredibly inefficient. So let's go and explore biceps brachii, because it is a brilliant muscle to look at. Just pull up the next slide. There we go. So you have to keep telling me if you can see the screen and you can hear me, because my screen's blank. I can't see what you're seeing. Anyway, so it's an intrinsic muscle. And what that means is the muscle attachments are within the limb. So an intrinsic muscle, your origin and your insertion arise within the limb, and it's found in the forelimb, obviously. It is a cranial brachial muscle. Look at your muscles as groups. So it's biceps brachii, pals up with brachialis and coracobrachialis. And all three are innervated by the muscular cutaneous nerve. So for those in the UK, if you think of it as your BBC muscle group, that's a really useful acronym to help you remember they are your cranial muscles of the brachium. Biceps brachii in the dog is really unique. It's really important that we look at specific anatomy for the species that you're working with. So it's got a single head, whereas in humans, it's two heads. And also in biceps brachii in the dog, it's a spindle shape. And we're going to explore that a little bit later in another slide. So in the human, we've got a fusiform shape. In the dog, it's definitely a spindle shape. It lies on the cranial and medial aspect of the humerus bone. And it's an amazing muscle with some great functionality that we need to know about, because then you can plan your treatment techniques to meet the needs of this muscle. So we know that triceps brachii is the key functional muscle of the forelimb. Biceps brachii, when working with triceps, is an antagonistic muscle. Okay, and when biceps comes into play, triceps is its antagonistic muscle. So these two have a great interplay that we need to know all about. On to the next slide. So let's look where the proximal attachment. So the proximal attachment, which you may know as an origin, comes from the supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula. And I always kind of think it looks like a little bit of a parrot's beak. So for me, that helps me remember it's coming from the scapula, passing over the shoulder joint, and through a long tendon of origin. It's got a very long tendon of origin indeed. So this long tendon of origin, which is attached to the parrot's beak, the supraglenoid tubercle, it passes cranially, so it passes forward cranially and then medially into the intertubercular groove. So on the right-hand picture, I've got a blue arrow that is pointing to the acromion. So the acromion is at the distal end of the spine of the scapula. The green arrow is pointing to the greater tubercle of the humerus. And the red arrow is where we're going to use red quite consistently for biceps through all the different pictures. The red arrow is highlighting the supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula. And that's where the tendon of origin attaches to. So biceps brachii tendon, which lies in the intertubercular groove, this lies between your greater and lesser tubercles of the humerus. And the left-hand picture, I really like to capture that with that red pipe cleaner. It passes cranially and it almost turns nearly 90 degrees medially to then pass down distally in that intertubercular groove. So on the right-hand picture, we've got the yellow arrow is identifying the lesser tubercle of the humerus. The green arrow is identifying the greater tubercle of the humerus. And the red arrow is pointing to that long tendon of origin that is going down that intertubercular groove. And there's a structure there we're going to look at next, which is holding it in place. It's a very important structure. So when it's passing distally in the intertubercular groove, it's held in place by the transverse humeral retinaculum. So what is retinaculum? It's essentially a band of deep fascia, and its function is to hold that tendon in place, and another structure as well, and it's to stabilize that shoulder joint and that shoulder dynamics. So it's incredibly important. Clinically, you may have a partial rupture of it, or you may have a full rupture. Full rupture is a really serious issue for the dog, but you may have a partial rupture as well. So distal to the intertubercular groove, the tendon actually widens up and becomes this spindle-shaped muscle that we were talking about slightly earlier. And in your large breeds, it can be actually 3 to 4 centimeters thick. So just measure that now with your hands and have a look. You know, hold your fingers up like that and realize how in the large breed, it's a really significant shaped muscle. Now, what's really important to help you understand why it's so important to look at species specific muscles is because the architecture of the muscle and the muscle shape, so how the muscle fibers are arranged and the muscle shape relates directly to the functions of that muscle in that species. So it's a really species-specific piece of anatomy here for you to really grasp, because so many people look at comparative anatomy, whether it's on a human, whether it's on a badger and a bear, which are plantigrade like humans, whereas a dog is digigrade. So the dog, it stands on its digits. So if you just take your feet now up onto the balls of your feet, that is the natural paw balance of a dog. So what we've got in the humans, we need to do this. I saw this in a video recently and I wanted to just bring it in. We need to be able to drink and eat. So we use our biceps brachii in a really different way because we're using it to flex our elbow. Now, dogs don't drink like that and they don't eat like that and they don't have a biceps brachii that works like a human biceps brachii. And we know that because if you just put your hand now on your arm, just under the skin, you're on biceps. Now in the dog, it's deep. We know that deeply placed muscles, it's under other muscles we'll talk about in a moment, deeply placed muscles are more about stability than movement. We also know in the human muscle is fusiform, okay? And it's got long parallel fibers because we want that range of motion. Now in walking, there's very little activity and motion at the shoulder and the elbow because, as discussed in the past bite-sized ones, the majority of your forelimb motion occurs on the scapula as it glides and rotates along that thorax wall. It's a very small amount of range of motion at your shoulder and elbow compared to the huge roll and glide of the scapula on the thorax. So we know that biceps brachii is a double pennate muscle, and that in itself is telling us the muscle fiber arrangement and the muscle shape allows for different functional roles. So this is where it gets really exciting, and I can't wait to tell you. Just below the tendon of origin, we've got these two extensive fibrous sheets, one slightly smaller than the other. So the smaller one lies from the tendon of origin over the muscle belly, between the humerus, between the bones, it's on the medial aspect of the muscle. Whereas the larger one covers about 70 to 80% of the muscle is covered by this extensive fibrous sheet, is covering the cranial and medial aspects. Now the green arrow, what that's doing, that's showing us something else. So what we've got is we've got pushed into the interior. So it's pushing into the interior of the biceps brachii muscle is this strong tendinous fold. And it looks on the outside, it looks like a groove, but it's actually a fold. And my story, my analogy to help you grasp this really important point is if you look to the right bottom picture here, you can see a French pleat on the back of a female head. So if you think of the hair folding in like that, so it looks like a groove on the outside, but actually there's a lot of folded hair inside, that kind of represents this interior fold, this interior fold of this tendinous structure inside. Now, the green on the French pleat is a ribbon. The little zigzag bit, which is just inside the hair, is deep. And then coming down the nape of the neck is the rest of the ribbon. And this is represented in the dog by a tendinous strand. So the biceps brachii, mechanically, it is designed to be a main stabilizer. And this strand that comes down through biceps and descends distally and goes into the antebrachial fascia, is a fantastic tensioning cord. And that backs up the role of the biceps as a stabilizer primarily. Now, this whole mechanical design is also supported by the fact that there is a high percentage of type 1 muscle fibers in biceps brachii compared to other muscles. Oh, thank you, Abby. I'm trying not to watch the chat and I just saw it went very quiet. So please tell me if you can hear me. Thank you. Yeah, and it's really good if you've got a, Alan, that's great. If you've got a chart, you've got your own dog, if you've got a skeleton, it's really good to have a visual backup. And you can go through this as many times as you want, but this tendinous strand is absolutely key in tensioning the tensor fascia in the antebrachii. The antebrachium. So it's tensing the fascia in the antebrachium, which is the forearm of the dog. So it's a very important stabilizing structure. So the top right picture there of the pipe cleaner, the red pipe cleaner, which represents biceps brachii, it's sort of medially placed and then it comes as it descends, coming a bit more cranially. So I hope that kind of makes sense. But the mechanical arrangement, as I said, it's further strengthened by a high percentage of type 1 muscle fibers. These are fatigue-resistant muscle fibers, which we find because they're ideal for postural maintenance. So having a look at the distal attachments or the insertion of biceps brachii, it's the proximal ends of the radius and ulna bones is where it actually inserts onto. And so biceps brachii has a function over the shoulder joint and over the elbow joint as well. And at the tendon of insertion, it lies on the elbow joint and it's actually covering the medial collateral ligament. So my next story to try and really understand the insertion of biceps brachii, because lots of people get a bit confused. Think of it as a snake tongue, a Y-shaped snake tongue upside down. It's got the thicker part of the snake tongue attaches to the ulnar tuberosity of the ulna bone. And the thinner part goes to the radial tuberosity at the proximal end of the radius bone. So that Y-shaped tendon of insertion of biceps brachii. The blue muscle you can see on the left picture is brachialis. I'm going to explore that in a moment. And its tendon of insertion lays deep to and between the snake tongue. I hope that helps clarify this very important relationship between biceps and brachialis, because they make the cranial muscles of the humerus. So the brachialis muscle, this muscle I've called for about 20 years, I've described it as the helter-skelter muscle. So those in the UK who've been on a helter-skelter at the playground will know what we're talking about. And I've got a little diagram in the next slide or two to show you. But essentially, it's a long, thin muscle and it lies in the spiral groove. Now, depending when you learnt your anatomy, the spiral groove is also known as the muscular spiral groove and is also known as the radial groove. Just depends when you learnt your anatomy. They're all the same structure. And basically, a large part of the lateral surface of brachialis lays deep to the lateral head of triceps brachii. So if you don't know that much about triceps brachii, if the information isn't at your fingertips, check out the Bitesize Canine Anatomy on it, where we really review it and understand the actions and the activity of triceps, because it's the key functional muscle in the dog's forelimb. So just having a look at brachialis, we've got it represented by the blue plasticine in the right-hand picture. It's this long, thin muscle that kind of wraps around the humerus like a helter-skelter. And in the next slide, it's got a common attachment with biceps brachii on those radial and ulnar tuberosities. You can see we've got a diagram of the helter-skelter in the bottom right. And you can see, so that's why I call it the helter-skelter muscle. And it's really important to know about it, because piggybacking it is the radial nerve until it gets to the lateral epicondyle, and then the radial nerve descends down into those extensors of the antebrachium. So a very important a sort of design feature to know about. So when we're palpating, we're thinking of using therapeutic touch, not just gross palpation. It's really important because we've got such strong research showing that the emotions of the dog, which affect the muscle tone, are really impacted by the kind of palpation techniques you employ. And we want to use a two-way communication. We want to, as therapists, pick up information. So where are we going to palpate biceps brachii? So this is really interesting. So in the human, you can palpate it directly in the, under the skin. In the dog, clearly you cannot, because it's a deeply placed muscle. So my top clinical tip, please, please have a look at this. Go and have a look at other multi-resources. The joint capsule of the shoulder joint continues under the tendon of origin of biceps and under into the intertubercular groove. So the shoulder capsule, which contains your synovial membrane and your synovial fluid, acts as an amazing cushion underneath the tendon of origin of biceps as it comes cranially, goes through a 90 degrees turn, and then goes medially. Now, what's the significance of this clinically? It is really significant. So it's underneath that transverse humeral retinaculum, which in these pictures is brown. The bottom right-hand picture is the tendon of origin passing. So it's a bird's eye view to try and help you perceive that. And in the two of the pictures, you're going to see a yellow color. And that is representing the synovial membrane within the joint capsule as it extends from the shoulder joint and acts as a fantastic cushion underneath that tendon. So clinically, when you're palpating biceps brachii, and you're locating your acromion, your greater trochanter, and your greater tuberosity, your greater tubercle of the humerus. I do apologize. So when you're looking at your acromion and your greater tubercle of the humerus, and then you're letting your fingers go cranially forward using a puppy hold or suitcase hold, not a pinch hold, you'll feel the edge of your greater tubercle of the humerus and just going medially. You will then feel the tendon of origin of biceps brachii. If you palpate any kind of effusion, any kind of swelling in there, you know clinically you have got a joint effusion of the shoulder joint. So a real top tip. So this is just to remind you that in the dog, biceps brachii is deep. It's covered by the pectorals, which in this diagram, we've kind of used black pipe cleaners. So the superficial pectoral muscles, which is the transverse pectoral and the descending pectoral, the transverse is deeper, cover the belly of biceps. So you cannot palpate the biceps belly. And on the bottom right-hand picture, you can see the long black strands of the pipe cleaners under the sternum. They're representing the deep pectorals. So the biceps belly is completely surrounded by pectoral muscle. You cannot palpate it directly, but you can palpate it at the tendon of origin, and you can palpate it at its insertion in the cubital fossa of the elbow joint. So muscle facts, this is facts. So let's really think about it. Primarily because of the architecture, the design, the muscle fiber type, we know that it is a stabilizer of the cranial aspect of the canine shoulder joint. And it's going to stabilize it in quiet stand, in natural balanced stance. And it's also going to stabilize it in the stance phase in canine locomotion. And this information with the anatomy and understanding therapeutic touch is going to make you realize how important using your static work on your underwater pods in the pool, your static work with the deep water in your underwater treadmill, static work, not dynamic work, is going to engage biceps brachii. Okay. It's also involved in active flexion. Now, the dog's limb, when it's walking, has a very small amount of elbow flexion. So the elbow flexion that is really important is at the end of elbow extension. So think of the dog taking a stride on the ground. You've got elbow extension, and that very last bit of elbow extension, just then the elbow starts to flex, is where biceps brachii works. It does not work as you go up a step. It does not work as you go up a table. Primarily, the muscle that's doing that flexion is brachialis. This is a really important point when planning your treatment program. And it's also a passive extensor of the shoulder joint, because the majority of your movement forwards of the limb is going to be, which is protraction, is going to be your key protractors like brachiocephalicus. So it's key role in the dog, very different to humans, very different to bears, very different to badgers, is going to be stabilizing the cranial aspect. So make sure when you're looking at your anatomy, you're species specific. So this is just to remind you, palpate in different postures, in sitting, in lying, in standing. And the bottom left-hand picture there is showing a finger and a thumb just on the two points where you're on the acromion and the greater tubercle of the humerus. Halfway between those is the shoulder joint, which is where I'm pointing in the top right picture. And the bottom right picture, I've kind of gone over the greater trochanter just slightly medially onto that tendon of origin of biceps. So I hope you found this really interesting. I'm going to look at the poll. I'm really interested to know what you're looking for in future bite-size anatomy. If you want me to go on, please go into the poll. Let us know. Do you want more muscles? Do you want muscles and joints? Do you want joints alone? And just to tell you about some sad news this week. So this wonderful dog who's going to be the dog in all our videos, our canine TVs, and all these crowdcasts, he's called Zach, and he was a soulmate of a very special person, and he died this week. And he was a very close friend of mine, and I'm going to miss him terribly. And I know he impacted positively on so many people's lives who've come to Canine HS courses, who've come to use our services and know this wonderful, wonderful elderly Labrador retriever. So, you know, just reaching out there to anybody who knew Zach. He's so important to us still, and he's going to be our significant picture on all our canine TVs. So hopefully you've got the message through. I sent out a message, a broadcast today. We've also uploaded one of our Canine TV instructional technical videos that we use in our level 3 and in our level 4 diploma, which is coming out at the end of next week. It's just a sample. It's just a sort of a taster of what instructional canine TVs are. It's a very small one, and we explore different details underwater, on land. We have a visual fest of information in the workshop style, plus real practice in clinic, to try and bring to you in a visual fest of information something you can see over and over again. So do go to Canine HS, our YouTube channel, and I have got a question, so I'm going to have a little look at a question. There we go. And if you want your CPD certificate, remember you need to go to the Canine HS website, claim your certificate through there. You need to submit your clinical reflection on how this may help your clinical practice. It's set by guidelines of IRVAP. IRVAP's got a new subgroup called ICH, and that's the Institute of Canine Hydrotherapists. And IRVAP represents a huge body of veterinary physiotherapists working full-time in the industry. And so it's set by those guidelines. So I do need a paragraph. If you just say a statement or start it, you'll get an email from me just saying it's a great start, but can you just give us a bit more to make sure we tick the box to get your CPD certificate, which is free. So the question that we've got, Emily Woodbridge, right. Okay, so I'm going to timestamp this. Emily's asked me, bicipital tenosynovitis, what is it and how would you treat it conservatively? That's another crowdcast, Emily, not passing it over, but this is about functional anatomy and I'm meant to do it in 25 minutes. I'm running slightly over as usual. I do apologize. But tenosynovitis is basically inflammation of your synovial sheath around that tendon, the tendon of origin. And treating it conservatively, that's a conversation. So if you want to do that, book a discovery chat with me through Canine HS Courses website, and we can talk more. But it's a really good question and something you see commonly. Oh, I've got another question just popped up from Linda Lucas. I would love you to cover fascia and future bite size. That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Lynn. I really appreciate you giving me that feedback. And there was quite a big message there from Alan in the chat. And it's a great reference for physiotherapy. There's also another really top tip with your agility and athletic dogs. With any issue with the biceps tendon, always check the paw balance with the dog because it has a huge impact on the sesamoids. And you can easily get sesamoiditis of just one or two of those digits that'll take fractions of a second off a performing dog. So Alan, I hope you found that a useful top tip. I wasn't going to share that in this particular crowdcast, but reaching out there, wanting to share as much as we can with you to help you plan those treatment techniques and plan your treatment program, working with the dog, being mindful of the behaviors in the clinical setting and working in a very proprioceptive and productive way to get the best outcomes the quickest we can for the dogs in our care. So thank you very much. I'm just going to check the poll. Let's have a quick look. It seems canine muscles and joints seems to, we've got 23 votes. So keep voting if you haven't voted and that will help us decide where to go next with these bite size. If you want to see more of them, let us know with feedback. And really look forward to seeing you in a couple of weeks. I've launched the next one. It's on March the 15th. It's a Sunday, 7 o'clock, and it's on gastrocnemius. Very, very exciting muscle if you want to know about powering and how to improve performance in the dog. Okay, bye for now.